Hello, everyone. Welcome to the first and the seventh annual Champinefu webinar series. The title of tonight's event in this series is Willamette River, Ancestral Highway. We're so happy you're here today. Thank you so much for being here with us. My name is Bonnie Brzoski. I'm a public services librarian at the Corvallis-Benton County Public Library. And I'm just gonna take a quick second to orient you to the platform that we're using today, which I'm sure many of you are well familiar with. It is Zoom. To submit questions throughout this evening's presentation that will be answered at the end of the event, please click on Q&A. It's usually in the top left corner of your window if you're using a computer, but it could be in various spots depending on the type of device you're using. Just a note that we are going to send a video recording of today's event via email to everyone who registered for this event within approximately 24 to 48 hours. The recordings are also eventually posted to the library's YouTube channel at a link that I'm going to share in the chat, where you can find recordings of previous events from previous years of the Champinefu series, as well as much more. So let me put that in the chat here. That's the library's YouTube channel. So as I said, this is a series, and the next event in this year's series is also virtual and will be held on November 9th from 7 to 8:30 p.m. It's titled Fire is Life, Living in Relation with Indigenous Fire Practices of Western Oregon. You're going to want to register for this free event in advance, and I'm going to go ahead and provide that link in the chat as well. And there you go. And then the final event in this series, it's a three-part series, is actually going to be in person at the OSU Alumni Center on December 12th. It will also be held from 7 to 8:30 p.m. and it is titled Winter Storytelling, Indigenous Stories of Place. You can read more about this event on the library's website. There's no need to register. You're just gonna wanna get there early to get yourself a seat, but here's the information about it in the chat. So I wanna bring on Dave Eckert, who's gonna tell us much more about the series than I have. I've just given you a little sneak peek. He's gonna introduce the series co-sponsors as well as our presenters tonight as well. Dave is part of the Mary's Peak Group of the Sierra Club and coordinates this event series. Dave, welcome.
Thank you. I'm going to, if I can do this right, I'm going to share my screen. And bring up the okay. There you go. Can you all see that? I guess. Okay, good. Well, thank you, Bonnie. And as Bonnie said, the title tonight is Willamette River, Ancestral Highway. And I want you to take a good look at this picture and the joy of that experience for people who are have built their own canoe and are living the cultural experience. This photo is by Freshwaters Illustrated, who has helped us on this program tonight. And David will tell you, David Harrelson will be telling you about that. This program over the last 7 years has come about really because communications and relationships with the Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde, particularly the Cultural Resources Department there. And for the last 6 years and now this year, the Grand Ronde has determined what the presentations are, the content, and the presenters. And so they have done all the work on finding out who is presenting to you. And we're so grateful for this relationship. And as I'm one of the organizations I represent is the Mary's Peak Group of the Sierra Club that did the original communications and still is the major administrator of this, just to make sure that this program happens, whereas the Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde do the selection of the, like I said, of the topics and of the presenters. In that very first year, the Spring Creek project out of OSU joined immediately and has been a both a financial and programmatic co-sponsor since 2017, and it's been a joy to work with them. And then in 2021, the Corvallis Sustainability Coalition, who I'm also represent in some certain cases, received a large donation from Francis Stillwell, a Corvallis resident, and that allowed the Corvallis Sustainability Coalition to also become a sponsor and major participant. And in the same year, as you know, that was during COVID, and we had to go online rather than live, and the Corvallis-Benton County Public Library offered to be the virtual hosts of these webinars, and that took a huge burden off of the other co-sponsors, and as Bonnie represents them, has been doing an enormous amount of work to make this happen. For that, we're also very grateful. And this year, we added another co-sponsor, the School of Language, Culture, and Society at OSU. And this is a big deal for us because now we're really wrapping in the entire community here around Corvallis in terms of not only co-sponsoring this, but being part of a reciprocal relationship with the Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde. And we're expecting just to really start taking off in many ways that we hadn't originally conceived, because we want to move beyond basically education and get into real reciprocity with the Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde. And we're beginning to feel like we're getting to have that momentum to do so. So enjoy this presentation tonight. I know you will, and I'm very excited about this personally, because I love the Willamette River, and it goes through Corvallis, or shall we say Champinefu, right? And here's a picture from Shalawa Point, another Kalapoya word. And the next time, remember Bonnie said we're going to be seeing Fire is Life, and that will be with Joe Scott. And he is with the Confederated Tribes of the Siletz Indians. And he has received a fellowship over the past year to study basic fire techniques of the many different types of indigenous fire practices of Western Oregon. And I do hope you register for that, because that will, like tonight, be a very special, special night. And as Bonnie said, in December, it's a Tuesday, December 12th, we'll be having the first live presentation since 2019. And this time it'll be at the OSU Alumni Center. Thanks especially to the two Oregon OSU co-sponsors, the Spring Creek Project and OSU School of Language and Culture and Society. And so we're really very pleased that they will allow us to be there. And that's going to be a very special night about winter storytelling. I don't believe that has happened for the general public here in Corvallis, and where the economy is being, some of the economy being told. And you just can't miss this. It will not be recorded in any form or fashion. So you have to be there. So I would like to introduce my good friend, David Harrelson, who I've worked with since 2017. David is such a joy to work with. He is a can-do person. We have a conversation. By the end of the conversation, he's come up with all these ideas, and I'm always stunned how good they are. And I guess I shouldn't be stunned anymore. But David, take it away, and thank you so much for doing all these years.
Wonderful. Thank you, Dave, for the introduction and the fellowship and work together through these years. I didn't ever think we'd do a year seven, but you make it such a joy and an ease to collaborate, and that commitment to reciprocity. It's really becoming a model of the type of collaboration that helps work for the tribe. And I'm just so grateful for yourself and all the sponsors and everyone who's taking your time to attend today and tunes in later to the recorded content. I'm, you know, so incredibly appreciative. The format tonight is we're going to share a sneak peek of a video project that the tribe's been working on. We're going to follow that by a panel conversation with people that have been active in the canoe community at Grand Ronde. Leading up to sharing the video, I'm going to just share a little bit of context. This video was developed, a big shout out and special thank you to Matthew Williams from the Grand Ronde Communications Department. Matthew has, you know, been doing the formatting and even included some of his own video footage that he took pictures and video footage from this last summer of going on canoe journey. And we've used this older video content that Jeremy at Freshwater Illustrated has, you know, provided the tribe access to, which is, you know, greatly appreciative. And he and they have been very clear about, you know, after taking that video content that it would always be available to the tribe. And this is the first time where we're really using that to help tell the story. I've said the word canoe journey. We've kind of talked about it. I think the first thing I have to do is just for everyone on this call, share a little bit about what canoe journey is, because probably many of you don't know. Around the 1980s, a canoe journey started actively in the Pacific Northwest. And there was this idea that an individual location would be chosen and different families from different tribal communities would get their canoes together and they would voyage and travel to that destination. And through the years, that's grown, and it includes tribal communities in British Columbia, Washington, Oregon, and sometimes there's people who come from far away, California, the East Coast. It's grown into an event now. Of course, like many things, COVID disrupted some of that and original plans, but this year there was a return to the water and canoe journey happened. Typically there's over 100 canoes that land at the final destination, yet all along the way, tribal communities are hosting groups of traveling canoes as they come into their community before moving on to the next community. What this has meant among tribal communities is this immense, what people, some describe as a cultural revitalization. Some would describe as just a place for the abundance of familial cultures to express themselves in a large sort of visible way. But there's protocols, there's songs, there's dances, there's inner community relations, right? People meet each other from other communities and get married and move to each other's reservations and have babies. And this has really bound a lot of the communities that actively participate in canoe journey together with one another in an annual kind of fellowship and gathering. And while many people that are my age or older, you know, those types of opportunities didn't exist, for younger people within our tribes that are adults now, many of them have participated their whole lives in having this large annual cultural event of expression and sharing, and it's resulted in a lot of community development. I selected and wanted to have conversation about canoes because it seems like one of the areas that we haven't talked about over the last 6 years. Most of the canoe work and canoe traveling that happens for us actually happens up in the Salish Sea or in British Columbia. We do some local traveling in our local rivers, but the canoe journey destinations are always further up north, which often looks like portaging upriver and or portaging up into the Salish Sea and then traveling. But we chose this because it's a big part of what's going on in the reservations and an expression of contemporary canoe culture. And I wanted you all to be able to see images and hear people talk about canoe culture, canoe community, and what was going on. And that's what that video is about before we launch into a conversation in kind of our panel and sharing information about it. A big part of this too is so much of the other information that we've shared is about historical facts and about images of the past. And I want you all to be able to see an example of Native people existing, living their full Indian selves in like a contemporary life, because that's what is happening today. And being able to like grasp and hear people's words about what it means to be actively living in that culture, I think is just really important and valuable. The other part is like what it looks like to actively maintain, you know, a living culture and have like abundance in those ways with one another, as opposed to like just focusing on how things were in the past, focusing on what exists now and what about those things like make and keep people strong, I think is really valuable and important. So that's why we're here today. We're here to kind of share that. There's going to be context that is set broad and geography, but there's also some information in the video that is very local. And Corvallis is on the Willamette River, which at the point of Corvallis is still comparatively big water, if you will. When you get upstream of Corvallis, you get into chutes and channels, and our larger canoes don't do as well in that area. You have to change and use a different type of canoe. You know, our ancestors and even us today, we have different types of canoes for different purposes. We have shovel nose canoes for chutes and tighter rivers, you know, that would be used to pole. You'd actually use a pole to move around. We have really small canoes that you can use to gather foods like wapato. And then we have the big traveling voyaging canoes, which are going to be the pictures that you see of today and the canoes that we take on canoe journey. These canoes are large. Right? They're not your aluminum camp canoe. Canoes that can haul tonnage, that can haul 24 people. These are different things that if you're not accustomed or you haven't been exposed to, you wouldn't think of those as realities for our ancestors or us today. And so we're really hoping that you take away from that, like seeing what living culture in today's world can look like. So with that, I think I covered all my points. Let me check real quick. I'm going to share screen and share video. And would somebody come on if the audio doesn't work and just tell me so I can reset it?
To be home traveling in our own waters that our ancestors did, it's relaxing. When we're traveling on the water here, you know, all the kids are just, they're looking at all the different stuff along the banks. We're telling them, hey, if you look this way and about so far back that way, there was a village. If we go right here, hey, you know what, just so far back there, this was one of our villages.
We'd have folks come up from Coquel and travel down the Willamette with us. Travel down the Willamette and down the Columbia. And really those times spent in the homelands have been like integral to like kind of reestablishing those connections. I think that historically that's how like our people viewed the landscape even, or it's really by going down river and getting associated and seeing places that you wouldn't have necessarily seen driving by on the highway or being on roads that you would have never been on to begin with. So you get out on the water, you get kind of a bit different perspective of the land as well.
It was like an orientation from the river. And when I think about what that means within the context of my ancestors, it's really powerful because how I understand my ancestors' understanding of place was based on that worldview from the river. And there's sayings and traditions that are captured in our stories, like people greeting each other and asking, "What news from upriver? What news from downriver?" Right? Everything's contextualized, or that Chinookan houses, their doors are oriented towards the nearest body of water. so many people are disassociated from the river, but there's this really beautiful thing that because of my involvement on the rowing team, the way that I learned about Portland was from a worldview from the river.
As a young person, you know, what I remember the most for myself is being in the canoe. And that was the best part for me at that time to learn. It was quiet sometimes. People were singing when people were paddling next to us. We would sing, like, though being in the water was like one of my top five things in my life that makes me who I am.
I've always really captured about how it feels like there's no development around you. Like you're going down the river and the greatest sign of development that you can see on 100 miles of the upper Willamette River is like an irrigation pipe that comes in like a half dozen, two dozen times. And the rest of the river just feels like a natural landscape.
Canoes returning to Grand Ronde was through Tony's canoe. We'd spend a lot of time down on the Salmon River, just running out to the beach, taking families out, hanging out, spending the day out on the beach, and just using a canoe to do that.
From the beginning, so Tony Johnson and Tony Farquet had been working on canoes, replicating the one out of the Oregon Historical Society.
There became an opportunity where we were hearing about tribal journeys. Tony Johnson had mentioned wanting to participate at one point because an uncle of his had participated over the years.
In 2003, we had seen the canoes come into Tulalip, and Tulalip was hosting that year.
I was watching all these canoes just pull in to the shore there. Well, I just remember folks asking for permission to come ashore. And people were singing also, people had masks on. And I had not seen anything like that in my young life at that point. And so when I was seeing this, I couldn't help but get emotional. It was something, almost something that I had been searching for that I had not understood at the time. I couldn't explain what was happening, except for I was like, what is like this overwhelming feeling of joy. That's what it felt like. If I think back and remember, that's what it was. It was just like joy. After that, I was a young person. You know, Travis and Bobby and a few other folks, Tony at the time, were sort of like thinking about how our community could, what we were gonna do to make sure that we were experiencing this.
We hung out for their protocol, stayed till the end that week, and just everything that we had seen done there, like, man, this is huge. Why aren't we a part of this? It's right in our backyard.
And then I think in 2005, we just kind of decided to do it. We decided to take Willie Meats up on journey, grab a couple handful people from here, a couple people from Chinook, and just head out and do it. After that first year on journey, I mean, we'd gone up where we didn't really even have any songs or anything. My cousin Bobby and I were both singers. We went up there, sang a bunch of stick game songs that were old songs from Grand Ronde, plus like round dance songs, which didn't necessarily have a place in the area. But really, it really filled us up going up. And like, when we came back on a mission. We came back to bring canoes into the area and to start to listen for those songs and look for old stories about songs and stories and canoes that related to us. And really just kind of putting us back into contact with that kind of historical cultural knowledge.
I was hooked. I had not experienced anything like that before. There was no way that I could have experienced it any at that time in my life that wasn't gonna be that impactful on me as a young person.
Kind of growing up in Grand Ronde, we didn't have a lot of access to a lot of like cultural knowledge. And it was like more of an effort to really seek it out. And really, as the more we learned, more time we just spent out kind of on the land and spending on waterways, starting to learn more traditions associated with that.
Cultural knowledge in the community when I was growing up and young felt scarce. It felt more limited. And what we saw was canoes provided access and a willingness of different generations of people to like come and practice the things that they know and share with each other in a way that was visible, seen, and allowed abundance, right? And it created a feeling of abundance within the community with all those people investing in their own ways.
One of the things that I think that canoes have brought is connection. Connection to self, connection to other canoe families, other canoe people, and connection to the water. I think the way that we have been able to develop in the last 15, 16, 17 years through canoe, this canoe life, has been an important part about how we identify. That sort of like sometimes something's missing, and for some people, this has been how I fill my cup up, how I stay healthy, how I stay connected. And for me, that is like for my community to see people feel that happiness, to feel that joy, to feel that connection is huge. It's important.
We knew we wanted to take kids up because we knew that that would be kind of the next step. And really that was something that really changed things. I mean, first we were kind of changed by going up there, but I think that a lot more came from being with the ability to take youth up there, because we hadn't grown up with it. These kids were starting to grow up with it. So we had like middle and high school students with us that after that first year on journey, we'd just spend days on the water and like starting to learn songs and then appreciate songs and like the kids starting to sing along with those songs with us. I mean, that wasn't even something anticipated necessarily, but it was something that just came. So that anytime we had any downtime, once we got home, I mean, that's what they wanted to do. They wanted just to be singing songs. They wanted to be working on dances. They wanted a plank house built. You know, they wanted all these things that really started to just seem to emanate from that time on the water and from in the canoes.
I mean, I see all of our kids are taken off with it. You know, we're almost at a point where we can step back and be like, you guys go skipper, you take the canoes, we'll hang out on shore, you know, or we'll be in the support boat if you need us, you know. And we have a whole nother generation that's stepping up and taking over, which is something that we hoped for. You know, and I mean, I think that's huge, and that we can sit back and see that our prayers are being answered. You know, our kids are—they're definitely not shy about being who they are, and that's something that we definitely prayed for. You know, in raising this next generation, was stand up and sing, stand up and speak your language. You know, you guys jump in the canoes, you come ashore, you know what the protocol is. You know, they're not shy about it. And something that we didn't grow up a lot with. And so for them to have that confidence of who they are and where they come from.
We're reconnecting with things that, you know, some of us have been searching for our whole lives, especially if we have elders there who haven't experienced that. And other times it's a great way to just be able to help people understand like what had already been happening for years.
We've gone down and found places to like gather, you know, by traveling on the water that you wouldn't have known existed.
You get to learn of like a whole new world that exists, and you can have fluency about that. Like you develop new words, right, just to understand like those moments in time that you have on the water, those experiences of what you see.
Being on the river gives you a different perspective of the land, places to go. Like, you don't even know about places until you've seen them from the water. I think that one of the biggest things for me is like being able to reconnect with like community. And like the time spent on the water is there's a lot of like self-reflection. So there's a lot of stuff happening like internally, like, you know, getting to better know myself, but also just like building like lifelong relationships and connections with community members while in the canoe. Because everybody's going through like, whether it be a difficult time or fun time, whatever it is, it's a long time usually. And it's a lot of, it's, you know, physically draining, you know, it's painful. But like doing that together with people is, I think, really something. And noticing just how things grow or how they're not growing, or whether that's a seasonal thing that you notice by spending more time on the water, you can tell, you know, like what's growing here now that wasn't here last time, last year at this time, you know.
And so if you're gonna ask a question, ask a question with the intention that you're learning something. Ask the question with the intention or the understanding that these folks, this is our experience. We're living a life just like you, it just looks differently. Although it's been a lot of years, we're still learning something every day about how we are in the world, how to connect to these lands, how to make sure that we're teaching our young people to care for this land, for these canoes, for these ways.
So, like, I think it just helped to bring more awareness to, like, the health of the river, which, like I said, also kind of impacts the land around it.
Being in those places, especially when you're paddling and you see these houses along the river there, and when we're singing, especially sometimes, like when you hear sometimes an echo of the song that you're singing, you just feel, it feels good. You're with your people, you're singing. When it's quiet also, when you kind of, you can find moments when you're just listening to the earth. You listen and people hear different things based on where they are in their life. And that's the type of stuff for me, like being in canoes, being on the water, being with your family, singing songs. Like for me, how people respond to that is what they need at that time, in that moment.
If our panelists could turn on their video and unmute their mics, we're going to start up the panel portion of this. Thank you again to Matthew Williams for his work on that and the communications department at the tribe to, you know, help kind of capture some of those stories that we can archive at Chichalu and kind of make available for people in capturing some of that story in the work. That's happened all these years. My first ask is, well, we go around and do like roundtable introductions, and just ask all the panelists to introduce themselves and their connection to community and canoe culture. Brian, are you open to start us off?
Hello, I'm Brian Krehbiel. I'm kind of born and raised around the area and just learned how to make canoes because of Canoe Journey, making us, we only had one canoe, so we needed more. And there was more of us, so there was a need for it. So.
Keone?
Sahayam. Hello, my name is Keone Mercier. This is my daughter, Kaya Mercier. I've been raised around the canoe. I was introduced at a very young age, around the age of 6. So, been a part of this life for a while now. I don't really know a time where the canoe didn't exist in my life. So I'm really looking forward to speaking about, you know, my experience along with my family members here, my dad, my uncle, my aunties, and just, you know, giving you guys an insight of how important this life is for us. Thank you. Hi, Leslie.
Tina? Christina?
Hello, everybody. My name is Christina, but Tina is obviously how people refer to me. I was, you know, as in the video, as a younger adult person working in our prevention program, sort of how I got started in the community and with this canoe stuff. So.
And Bobby.
Hello, everybody. My name is Bobby Mercier. You might hear a bunch of yelling in the background. I'm at a football game. But I work for the tribe, and I am a cultural advisor and the skipper of our big canoe there, Stone Kia.
Great. Thanks, everybody. I think my first question is just a really open-ended one, which is, there was a lot of different things that were said there, but were there any like topics or themes that you found that sort of stood out that you want to add on to that maybe weren't covered, or you think something that would be like really helpful for the audience to know? Everyone's gonna point here, so Bobby,
go ahead.
Go for it, Bobby.
You know, just thinking of one of the biggest things that we've seen, you know, even when we started the first journey of not having our own canoe in Grand Ronde, and seeing everything that it had done for the small group of us that went on that first canoe trip, and just seeing what the canoes have done for our community today is a huge difference than how we were, say, in 2004. And we see it in every single thing that we do, up and down our streets, to our community, to our preschools. And so we see what it has brought back to our families and our communities.
Right.
Oh, I was just the camp life of journey, you know, and what that means of traveling on journey. I didn't see, I seen us all standing there singing and stuff, but it didn't really show the nuts and bolts of us being in a camp, the size of the camp that we usually travel with, you know, say 40 people, you know, camping at one time. That's quite an accomplishment, you know, throughout journey. You know, it's usually 2 to 3 weeks, depending on where the destination is how long we go camping and travel together in our canoes. And so watching that whole video, I was, you know, I noticed we didn't have a lot of campsites, you know, showed. So that was something that I thought would be interesting. To camp life is always fun.
Yeah, are there any certain parts of camp life that like stand out, or things that happen there that
There's probably not a tent in this world we can't put up.
Good.
I'll add real quick, you know, the part where Tina had mentioned, like, how being out on the water, you know, for some people, it fills your cup. It fulfills, you know, your spirit, your life. I know that in my experience, living a culture and, you know, modern life, I feel most strong and most happy when I'm in that canoe or when I'm in that water. And, you know, all the struggles that we have dealing with modern life and modern living and the struggles that we go through, it seems to cease out on the water, you know, that it can be painful pulling for so many hours and so many miles, but at the same time with every stroke and every, you know, every time you dip your paddle in that water, it's like you're letting go of everything that, you know, you're dealing with outside of that. And so that water, whether it's rough or whether it's flat and calm, it brings the strength that you need in order to get through this life. Because, you know, living modern life, it is a struggle. And I tell you that every time we come in that canoe or we're singing or we're dancing, I definitely feel a little bit stronger. I feel a little bit more content and my spirit is fed, and it feels, you know, again, my cup is full. So I wanted just to add to what Tina said, because it really did, you know, strengthen my life as a young Indigenous person to understand that I've always had an identity. I've never felt lost. And I'm very fortunate for that, because, you know, these people that are on this panel right now, I know that there was a time where they didn't have that. And they're the ones that took on that responsibility to give us that life. So, you know, I'll never know a day, and my daughter will never know a day, that our identity doesn't exist. It exists always. So I just wanted to add to that. Thank you.
Does Christina, does anything stand out for you, or things kind of in reflection?
No, I feel like I think I said pretty much, you know, and Keone did a really good job of just adding, you know, her experience to that, which I really appreciate. So I'm pretty solid right now.
Good. I'm imagining folks have like some interest in kind of like the process of like why a canoe is designed the way a canoe is, like what is a design, like what goes into the design of a canoe. And we have a canoe builder on the panel, right? So I'd be really interested in, Brian, if you'd be willing to kind of talk about like designing canoes and maybe also paddles and the differences in paddles.
Sure.
Just knowing like where we're from and what types of waterways we come from, different waterways provide, you know, like rough water, white water down south, you know, southern Oregon tribes, anywhere, you know, Umpqua down, would be, you know, a different shovel nose versus a normal shovel nose that you'd see, more of the Yurok style. Is people are familiar with the Yuroks right now, and they have a, where you can go travel with them on the water now, like a tourist thing. And so you get to be in one of our southern style canoes. There's a little bit of difference there inside the canoe, but the shape outside is still the same shape as ours. And then our Corvallis area tribe, you know, like our Kalapuya people through the Willamette Valley, had nice shovel noses up until the falls. And then we get into where you got the ocean going canoes, which have fins on them in the front and back. There's fins, like the big canoe that you see us traveling in a lot. That would have been seen probably below the falls, never up on the, smaller canoes, right? Would have been able to carry up above the falls, but there would have been no need to take a giant, you know, canoe like Stankia up there, because they would have had, I actually grabbed it down, they would have had more of a river canoe, a Kalapuya style canoe on the river all the way down to the falls, taking their camas and whatever else they had for trade there. And then designing the canoe, well, just like, you know, how big's your family, you know, how big do you really need? And do you need a plus one, you know? So, you always, whenever people are thinking of designing a canoe or wanting a canoe, they say how long they want it, but then they want to shove a bunch of people in there. And so the canoe likes to sit just right in the water. And so depending on if you overload it, then it sits kind of different in the water. And that means you need a bigger canoe. Or if you only have three people, well, you shouldn't take off the biggest canoe, you know? So that's always fun, designing a canoe. before we just designed it out of the log that we have choice, you know, that was whether we seeked out the log, if we're that fortunate enough to seek out a log and carve, then you would get a stick about, you know, an inch per foot scale. You'd try and do something like that, take a branch, you know, and then try and scale it to that log and then carve yourself that stick into them. That's what would make your canoe. That's what size of canoe you'd get out of that log, kind of. And so it really went into a lot of technical stuff after that, you know, but just same with our paddles too and our waterways. We wouldn't use a Chinookan paddle, you know, on the rough water, you know, like say coming down white waters, because then you'd hit rocks and stuff and they'd break the ears off. I don't know if everybody can see the paddle behind you, David, but those are our Chinook paddles there. And there's a hook there. You could see it. It's got two points, and those weren't made for whitewater rafting. So different paddles, you know, when they say, oh, there's this really elegant, and then how come this one looks like this? Well, this one's made for beating up rocks, and this one was made for just dipping in the water. So I hope I answered enough of that.
Yeah. Absolutely. I think one of the other things I hear a lot when people are asking questions is like the colors of the canoes. Oh, like, yeah. What is there a history to that or an understanding of why, or is that a new thing?
The ochre red is what they would get that, you know, that pigment from. And the black would just be from charring it. So when you're steaming it open and you get it all cured, I think there's stuff in the Tillamook text that talks about them boiling whale blubber inside the canoe and then scraping off the broth off the top of it, like the foam, and then bringing it over the sides of the canoe to kind of help seal it. And so with that fat, with that whatever that froth that they scraped off the top. And then they said they would use that ooligan grease to grease up the canoes just to make it so it wouldn't take on water and waterlog. You know, we've had canoes what didn't have the right sealing on it, and they made it partially down our little trip we did with the Willamette River keepers. They started at Newburgh there, and we only went to Champinefu, and when they were pulling out, their canoe was actually underwater. They were just as they got to the dock, it had went underwater because it didn't have the right sealer on it. They made a river canoe, which was cool. Just we didn't know what to seal it with. And so I guess they did their best. And that's how we found out that's why they charred them and rubbed that charcoal into them with that grease. And so that's how you get that black.
Throughout this in the presentation, there's been some names that have been named, which are names of different canoes. And I was wondering if somebody would be willing to talk about like the naming of canoes and like what that means, and maybe give some examples of the canoes in our community and their names.
Bobby, you could talk about Stankia.
I was working on it. I was trying to press my unmute, but you know, our big canoe, when we first brought our big canoe home, Stankia, in 2000, beginning of 2006, we brought it home, that we had talked about what that canoe was going to do for our community, and looking for a name to put on that canoe so that we could really make it stand out, and not just, it's not just like an English name you're going to put on something. And that name is Stankia. It's one of the oldest names that we have for coyote in our Clackamas language. And in the story, in that story of coyote, he was a changer, and he changed the world so that we could be here. So he changed where the mountains were, the rivers were. And so he changed the world so that we could be here. And he did the work for the creator in that way. And when we were going to bring the canoe home, we were looking for something like that, and that name stood out because we knew the change that it was going to make in our community. We knew the change it was going to make for our people. And so we put that name Stankia on there and had a ceremony for the canoe. So these canoes all have ceremonies done for them. We have ceremonies to wake them up in the early spring. We have ceremonies to put them to sleep, which we're getting ready to do here next month. And so it's not just a name on a canoe, but it also carries a life and a story with it as well.
So for each canoe, when they're born, basically, because they're made and created, it's like giving life to everyone who gets to partake in the canoe. And so the canoe becomes your family member, because the canoe will take care of you. And we know what it's done for our hearts, like that healing that it's done for us while we're in it. We all have experienced that sense of being that camaraderie with one another, you know, and all these wonderful blessings that come from witnessing the canoe, that name, that you remember your brother, you know, you remember your Stankia, you know, your Chupi or your uncle or whoever you want to call Stankia. There's all these changers in us. And so when we get these canoes and someone asks you a name like Ohayu, that one just came from someone asking, what are you going to name her? And I was like, well, I didn't know we named them hers, even though they are the shape, the embodiment of the womb. And that's what the canoe shape is for the ocean going ones or Chinookan ones. And so they're mostly named girls. And I didn't know that about all around the world. Most boats are, you know, named like after, you know, the female. And so, Ohayu was seal, because we were dealing with seals at the falls. And so anyways, that's where Ohayu got her name, was someone asked what you're going to name her. And then we tried to pick a name for her that would be fast in the water, because she was fast. So, and those are our two canoes right now. Besides the new recent one, Chicha, Grandma is what we named that one, just because everybody and their connections to grandmas. I felt like if it was going to be for the clinic and healing, we have Chupi, which is kind of like, Stankia is our Chupi, you know, he's our old one, you know, and then we needed a Chicha. So that's how that came.
Great. Thank you. Do any of you have stories about traveling in home waters that you like remember, that you like want to share, like that idea or any like accounts, kind of, you know, Brian shared the story of paddling with Willamette River keepers, or sort of like memories of being in home waters or different times where you've been paddling or different locations that were memorable to you?
I'll let you go, Keone.
All right. There's one memory that I have, and I think it was the Willamette, but we had some of our Maori friends come over, and we were paddling with them. And you know, we all know what the waters are like, so we don't really go swimming that much in there. But it was funny, because as soon as we got out, they jumped right in, and I remember all of us community members look at him like, ooh, I don't know about that one. But also just like the fact that our waters have had so many different people paddle in that waters, and we've introduced them, you know, to our ancestral highways, and also returning that favor and going over as well and paddling in different waters. It just shows you that, like, continuing this life, especially in our waters that are at home, it's going to take you so far. So I've had so many memories of going with the Willamette keepers as well and paddling with them, seeing kayaks beside me, seeing little fish jump as well, and just remembering that it gets really hot out there on those days too. And it's fun because we always have our children too, like especially at home, and they get to just have fun, because, you know, our Willamette River is different than being out on the big waters. You know, it's a little more calm. We can, you know, have elders and children, and there's so many times where I just remember as a kid going there and always introducing a lot of people who aren't from here to paddle with us in our waters. And it always feels so nice, because even though you see the city when you're getting, you know, in the water, you start to go down the river and you lose all of that. You finally get to just see some of the natural things that, you know, our ancestors were seeing. It's kind of, it takes you back a little bit to realize like, oh, I can be peaceful here. I'm not overstimulated by the city itself. I can just be in the water and be with the water and whoever you're in the canoe with as well. So just a little bit of that.
One of the questions in question and answer, which would go at the end, but we're pulling those, is about how old does somebody need to be in the canoes? And you were just talking about kids.
Yeah.
Speak to that, Keone?
I mean, I was 6 when I first got in. My brother, he was only 3. Yeah. And I mean, we've had women with babies in the womb being in the canoe. Mm. So there isn't really an age limit. It just depends on how the pole looks and if it's going to be safe or not. But
Brian, I know you've been teaching your youngins to
babies. Yeah, babies. I was going to definitely say it's all on what you want for the day. You know, if you're at a fair, you know, you protect them with sun, out of the sun, you know, so you put a hat on them or sunblock, you know, and it's dangerous wherever, you know, so water is one of those dangerous things that, you know, doesn't really matter who you are, you know, they'll take you if they want. So you got to wear protection, you know, and life jackets. And I tend to maybe bubble wrap my kids a little more with a couple jackets and a inner tube, you know, but they've been out as, I don't know, 10 months old, sitting on my lap as I'm skippering. So that was one thing about the Willamette, talking about traveling on the Willamette, was getting asked to skipper for the first time. And I was like, oh, that's a, you know, if anybody ever goes on journey and knows the skipper role or has been there, and it's kind of a hot seat, you know, and I always wanted to know when do I get a chance, you know. Well, I didn't ask that day, even though Tony Johnson, our friend, had something come up and he needed me to skipper. And I was like, are you kidding me? There's several other people all on this beach. Ask somebody else, you know. And he said, no, I'm sure you'll take care of her, you know. And I'm like, all right. So yeah, we skippered down from Mission State Park is where we're at, outside of Salem. And we had went all the way down to Newburgh and out to Champui. And it was quite interesting once we got in by Newburgh and all the skiing, all the boat traffic. It was pretty hectic there. And being in a little canoe with a bunch of big guys in there, we kept taking water on, and they asked me if this is always supposed to happen. And I'm like, I don't know. I've never been in this canoe. It's a little canoe, you know. And so it was Tony's Uli Meets, a little 21 footer. And you have to go over the waves. You can't just take a wave on your side, or else it almost wants to just jump in your lap. And so, yeah, it was quite the experience.
Could you talk about the role of the skipper? What's the role of the skipper in the canoe?
Sure. The role of the skipper is to know how the canoe performs in the water. Like if we need someone to paddle on the right or left, up forward, you know, all the way up front, our lead pullers. I truly believe if you've sat in every seat in the canoe at least once, then you have the right to sit in the skipper's seat, because you've done your time. You've learned the canoe. You've learned yourself a lot, you know, because that canoe will ask things of you in a certain way. If the water's doing something different, if the current's doing something different, you kind of have your head on a swivel, always looking at your surroundings, because sometimes boats don't see you. Even though we usually have a relief boat guy out protecting us. Our relief boat is, we've mentioned that a couple times. That's usually we have a Zodiac that floats alongside us and carries our water and keeps us safe. And so, but even then, sometimes they don't see them. Those big yachts, they get going pretty quick out there. And yeah, it's pretty fun. And most of the big water, when Keone was talking about big water, is mostly up north when we go on the Puget Sound there. Yeah, that's big water.
Right. Tina, are there any stories of big water, or no? No, you're good. All right. I do want to just remind all of our attendees that I guess we'll open up question and answer. So if you have different questions, you can put those in the chat, and I'll invite Bonnie from the library to come back on and kind of pose some of those questions. While we're in transition, I do see a question about paddle designs again. And with those behind my head, I'll just talk about maybe what you're seeing. So the red and black paddle that you see behind my head, that it, when you're hearing the Chinookan paddle or with the ears that Brian was talking about, that's the paddle that we're referring to. And there's, you know, we have the things that it's probably for, which is like pulling through kelp beds or kind of, you know, being able to really grab onto things, but not rocks. We jokingly sometimes say it's for holding down baby seals to club them. That's a bad joke. Then the other ones that you have is you've got a Tillamook paddle. That's the one with the ridge down the middle, and it has the diamond shape at the top. And that's something that Tillamook people out on Tillamook Bay, Tillamook County area, right? That's a type of paddle that they have. One question that I don't know, but it was in that kind of, is that a lot of kayak paddles and others are squared off at the bottom, but it doesn't seem like there are squared off paddles in traditional canoe paddles, but they're not the kind of the norm, the universal norm. Does anyone have a thought about why that might be?
For our paddles on the Willamette, some of those ones were kind of squared off, kind of roundish, kind of squared off from hitting rocks, and because you'd use it for a pull too as well as your paddle, depending on if you're, you know, you were traveling on the Willamette. But and I believe the Rogue River has some squared off paddles too. They're more beat up too from hitting that white water.
Great. I did see that someone raised their hand, and we're only going to be taking question and answers in the chat. So if you could put your questions into the chat, that'd be great. Bonnie, is it okay for me to just kind of go through and read them, or should I pass to you? Okay.
You're doing a great job.
Okay. Awesome. Yeah, I can see it. I'm host. I have powers. Oh, goodness. I'm a co-host. There was a question about how the canoes are transported, you know, besides paddling. I like had mentioned portage and things like that. Is anybody up to take that?
Our trailers, our canoe trailers. We buy boat trailers and retrofit them to fit a canoe, which is how it works. Or put them on top of your car. I've done that.
Yeah. Yep. Do you always have a name for a canoe? What helps you decide on a name? What's like an inspiration?
I'll give you a quick one of my daughter's canoe. I was carving the nose and a blue jay landed on the tail. And so that's why I painted it blue inside. I put in our Tillamook blue, and I named her Case for blue jay because the blue jay landed there, and I was like kind of taken by, you know. And then my grandma always had blue jays out of her house. So I was like, oh, blue jay's a good name. So, and my other canoe's name's Kingfisher. Cause when I took it out on the water for the first time, to get seat placement, cause I was trying to figure out where I was putting my thwarts. Cause I'm a canoe builder, so they don't just come pre-measured and whatever, you got to adjust to anyways. It either was mating season or something, but there was about 30 Kingfishers at the pond that day flying all over the place. And so, I named that Kingfisher because I figured it was a sign. Yeah.
There's a question about material type for canoe paddles. Is there a certain type of wood? But I'm going to also kind of extend that question to canoes. Canoes and paddles, are there certain types of wood that's better to use?
Western red cedar for the canoes, and the ash, or, well, I only thought the tree grew in Oregon, so I always called it Oregon ash, but that's how small my world is. Evidently ash grows all the way back to New York, so the ash tree is that's our traditional paddle style. We do use I've used other cedars to make paddles as well.
Great. another question is, and this is a good kind of round table question for each of our panelists. What do you see or wish for in the future with canoe culture? What does this look like in 50 or 100 years? Bobby?
I would say more canoes, families owning their own canoes, canoe parked in everybody's driveway. I think that would be my wish.
Oh, I'll go ahead. You know, I think for me, as I've mentioned sort of in the video, is what these canoes have brought is this sort of like, you know, this healing and to our community. And so as more canoes are being built, that our community is also feeling that healing and that connection. So, you know, really building that community around canoes and also I agree with Bobby, more canoes in our community, that people feel comfortable to be able to like, yeah, if you want this, it's right here, you know, and making that decision. So.
My dad took the words right out of my mouth. We share a very similar mind. Oh, yeah. Okay. Basically, like just having more river canoes too for like us women, because I've always heard stories about these shallow canoes that some of our women would have, especially when they would go out in like those little marshy areas to collect like wapato and stuff like that. And my dad, one of my favorite stories is one of my dad talking to me about how the women would, which I personally think I'd be really good at this, is they would dig it up with their toes. They would get it with their feet and pop it up and grab it and throw it in their canoe and walk into these little, like, you know, shallow marshy areas and throwing all the wapato in there. But yeah, like, see, you go into these other communities and you see that there's a lot of these people who are making canoes for their own families, and they're just parked all through the reservation. And that's like such a, that is the hope. Like that is what's in my prayers, like to see that all of us kids, especially because our dads are really super talented, maybe we'll all get a canoe each and just have it whenever we want, could pass it down to this little one and just hopefully teach her how to take on the water, you know. But that is the hope.
Wonderful.
She had to give her 2 cents in that.
Yeah. We have a special shout out for your baby, Keone, as thank you for bringing your baby. And there was a request about pronunciation of canoe, the tribal word. I think Kaneem, somebody said that. So it's Kaneem. Which, if you're familiar with towns in Oregon, the town of Kanema, upstream of Willamette Falls, is actually derived from the name Kaneem because it's on the primary portage side of Willamette Falls. And like we've talked about in many of these other sessions, there's a lot of our names that are across the landscape, even if they're not a direct relationship. So the town isn't called Kaneem, it's called Kanema, and it's spelt differently, but that's definitely the origin of the town's name, which is kind of a cool thing. There's also another question, which I'm just going to answer quick, about do people harvest a wapato from canoes? And we can, except for there's just not as much of an abundance of wapato as there would be. And so even if we could do that, in order to do it, we'd probably be harvesting a lot of wapato to fill the canoe. And in order to harvest the wapato that we feel is sustainable, we generally don't have to go out into the middle of a lake because there isn't that much. And we don't want to impact it to the point where it won't be there anymore. So that's a big hope. You know, there's restoration projects going on throughout the Columbia and Willamette Rivers and at Wapato Lake. And that would be an amazing thing to see, is see wapato gathering at that scale again, right? And having the need to build those canoes so we could get our community out there. Like, that's a really cool goal to look forward to. And But, you know, that probably will take 50 years, right, in order to get to the point where we have those types of populations. We had a question that I thought was a really good one. And, you know, what role or how do traditional foods play a part in canoe journey?
Besides from all the clam bakes and lobster and crab and salmon about every night. I don't know. Good eating.
Yeah.
Helps pull people to pull strong the next day when you're pulling for 6 to 8 hours and doing anywhere from 20 to, you know, 35 mile pulls. Traditional foods all the way around us, even all the way down to the snacks we get, so that we can keep going all day long.
One is, you know, the question is posed in a way, is it expensive for each family to have their own handcrafted canoe? Which I think, yes, but comparatively for all the time and the effort that goes into it, it's a deal, right? I think that's the other part. And I really try to share this with people being familiar with other, you know, if people buy boats, and canoes are not boats, but, you know, those things are expensive. And because it's wood, or it's not a different, it's not aluminum, it still has the ability to be expensive. Rowing shells, you know, cost $20,000 to $40,000 for a 40-foot rowing shell, right? So the idea that you'd pay anything less for a canoe would seem a little odd, given that there's probably, you know, it's much more craftsman oriented to like a traditional canoe. So that's kind of how I vaguely answer it, but I'm not the canoe builder. Does the canoe builder want to weigh in about the pricing of his craft?
Yeah, it's definitely, it's went up, it's went up a ways since before, and getting the quality of wood that say, if I was to get a Western red cedar, that was for the other question too, back when they asked about what kind of woods we had used for our canoes. These ones that you're seeing right now are a hybrid made of modern materials with the same engineering focus of the shapes that we had, everything engineered down to its weight and how it moves in the water. And so in our southern tribes, they used redwoods down south, so for a different style canoe, for that one question they asked about what woods there. Mm-hmm. But anyways, yeah, I would say you go into the store and buy some 2x4s which are not rot resistant and make something out of it, and then they rot, you know, so we have to spend more money on white oak, you know, different marine grade plywood, which is, you know, $100 and some a sheet of plywood. And it takes several sheets of plywood to make these canoes, with a West system epoxy is what we use with fabric. And so it gets pretty expensive, by the foot. I just cut up $1,800 worth of fabric today, for some canoes. I'm making some for another tribe. That question that you guys had about in 50 years, more access to our canoes, a tribe's ordering 12 canoes from me, and 7 of them are going out to the general public. They're going to be kind of sponsored through their tribe so they can own their own canoe, which is super, super cool and amazing that a tribe is able to do that, and offer it to their tribal members. So hopefully we get something like that, down the road.
Yeah, that's awesome to hear about that. I think we're at time. So I know we have a couple questions that didn't get answered, and I apologize for that. I'll do my best. If you send an email to cultural.resources@grandround.org, I can put it in the chat as well before we sign off. And if you have something that you want to follow up with, please just reach out. But I guess just we'll do roundtable of like parting thoughts or anything that you might want to say before we close out.
If anybody has any questions for me, and if you guys have my contacts, feel free to share them. I'm okay with answering more questions through emails if that works for folks.
Ryan is the owner of Agency Creek Expressions, and he also has a website that you can go on and check out his website and message through the website as well.
Oh yeah, you could do that too. Yeah.
Is that, I just want to make sure we're repping so that people know that you're Agency Creek Expressions, same guy, same thing.
Yeah. Okay. I don't know how quick I'll get to the yeah. webpage.
Yeah.
Totally. But my email is pretty quick.
Good. Okay.
Thank you guys for having me.
Yeah, I just wanted to say thank you guys for having me and my baby and just letting us share our experiences. And I look forward to watching this again.
Christine is good. Bobby, you want to say anything to close out?
I don't know. My daughter said a lot there. I wonder where she gets it from, but anybody wants to ask me anything, you can get a hold of me at bobby.mercier@grandround.org or just do the one that David said, cultural.resources@grandround.org. You can get a hold of us through there. I'm not hard to find. I work at the museum there.
Good.
Yeah.
Well, thank you all. I think my last public service announcement to the audience is that through the beginning of November, our exhibit Shimhen, My Father's Father's Sister, that's about an indigenous queer medicine person from the Grand Ronde Reservation in the 1800s, is on display. And just this last week, we opened a new exhibit called Stick, and it's all about tribal uses and interactions with the woods, with the forests, with trees. And it's really spectacular, and there's some really great kid interaction aspects to the exhibit. And I would just encourage you all to come out and visit Chichalu, our museum and cultural center. We're open Tuesday through Saturdays, 10 to 4. Admission is free. If you're interested in a group tour, it's best to call ahead, but any smaller group, self-guided, you're more than welcome to just stop in during open hours. And it's a real pleasure and an honor. And I will turn it back to Bonnie for any administrative closeout.
Yeah, just really a huge thank you from me and the library to all of you for being here tonight. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dave, for helping coordinate and getting all of these groups together. And thank you, David, so much for always getting these wonderful presenters and people to share these really amazing stories with us. I'm lucky to be a part of this. So thank you all. And thank you, audience, for joining us. And I hope that you will share this with others, and I hope you enjoyed it. So good night, everybody. We'll sign off. Take care.
Bye.